Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the second addition to my strategic library. Tonight, I'm going to be talking about Flow, the Psychology of Optimal Experience by Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. And if I butchered his last name, I do apologize. It's a doozy. That being said, let's go ahead and get started. This book deals with some pretty heavy topics right out of the gates. In fact, it mentioned Aristotle and something he said 2,300 years ago. He said more than anything else, men and women seek happiness. And whereas happiness is sought for its own sake, every other goal that we have in life, getting a fancy house or expensive clothes or having a high-paying job or getting married and having kids or having multiple vehicles and a big TV, all of these goals are valued only because we think that they're going to lead to some degree of happiness. That's why we pursue them. Now I can keep on rambling on about the different types of goals that people strive for. However, within the Western civilization, I can actually simplify those to three. We are after wealth, power, and sex. These are the chief goals fueling the vast majority of our society. I should probably note at this point, if you only end up following the goals that other people have given you, you are a thoroughly socialized individual. And if you think about it, all the goals that I talked about are pretty much grafted onto our genetically programmed desires. This includes our sexuality and our aggression and our longing for security and our receptivity to change. All of these are being exploited as a source of social control. Politicians will do this, churches will do this, corporations, and, believe it or not, advertisers are going to exploit our preferences for their own ends. It shouldn't come as any surprise that those people who end up pursuing goals that were given to them, but they really haven't taken the time to figure out what sort of things are going to lead to any lasting happiness, these individuals are going to experience a lot of frustration, a lot of anxiety, and a lot of boredom. In fact, frustration is going to be deeply woven into the fabric of life. Thankfully, cultures aren't stupid. They're well aware that if the vast majority of its population is perpetually in a state of afflictive emotion, there are going to be some long-term consequences they're going to have to face. So they've developed some protective devices in the form of religion and philosophies, art, modern comforts. All of these were designed to help shield people from their own inner chaos. Although I don't necessarily agree with Mihai on this next point, he ends up claiming that entropy is the normal state of consciousness. And if you're unfamiliar with the term entropy, it basically means that everything is moving towards a state of a disorder. It's a condition that's not very useful and not very enjoyable. To avoid this rather uncomfortable state, people are more than willing to turn their attention towards any information that's readily available, so long as it distracts them away from their own inner dwellings that are just not that pleasant. You might be asking yourself, what is the most common form of distraction within our modern society? Well, it's occupying an insane amount of hours watching a bunch of actors pretend to have adventures and being engaged in mock meaningful actions. That, by far, is how people spend their time. So who are the ones who are especially susceptible to becoming captives of the media? These are the people without an internalized symbolic system. They're going to be easily manipulated by fearmongers, pacified by entertainers, and exploited by anyone who has something to sell them. If you become overly dependent on drugs or TV or on the fanatical calls of politicians and religious salvation, it's because you have very little to fall back onto. There's not a lot of internal rules to keep your mind from being taken over by those who claim to have all the answers. By the way, if you actually think that there's something or somebody out there that's going to turn all of the chaos in your mind into something orderly, you are sorely mistaken. That is not how you improve the quality of your life. Only direct control of your experience, which is the ability to derive moment-by-moment enjoyment from everything you end up doing, can overcome the various obstacles that are preventing you from being fulfilled. You know, it is actually kind of funny if you think about it. For the past few centuries, we've been living with an economic rationality that pretty much ends up saying that the bottom line of any human effort can be measured in dollars and cents. This is an incredibly irrational way of thinking of things. The true bottom line is actually the quality and complexity of our experience. That is what's truly important. That being said, The moment that we can enjoy and find meaning in the ongoing stream of experience is the moment that the shackles of social controls will end up falling from our feet. Instead of perpetually reaching out for the prize dangled just outside of our reach, we finally get to enjoy life as it is. As long as you're continuing to obey the socially conditioned stimulus, which is like the carrot on the end of a stick, which is a response pattern that exploits our biological inclinations, you are being controlled by the outside. All right, let's look at the other side of the equation. Whereas most people are in need of external stimulation, going to the television or reading a book or conversing or doing a myriad of different drugs, all of which are pretty much keeping their minds from drifting into chaos, there are people out there who have a memory that's stocked with patterns of information that makes them autonomous and self-contained. Not only that, these people are valuable companions because they can share that information with others. And not only that, if they're lucky, they can end up bringing order to other people's minds by giving them insights on how they can better control themselves. Therefore, thusly, we might as well hit on a reoccurring theme throughout this series, and that is happiness does not depend on outside events. It depends on how you end up interpreting those events. Sound familiar? Well, it should. We're going to be coming across this topic over and over and over, so you might as well get used to it now. So the next time you find yourself in a stressful situation, whether you profit from it or become miserable by it is entirely up to you. The person who ends up controlling their own inner experience is basically going to determine the quality of their lives, and this is about as close as we can get to becoming happy. This is not a new idea. Epictetus, if I pronounce his name right, I'm gonna butcher names all the way throughout this series, so you'll have to get used to that as well, ended up saying that men are not afraid of things, but how they view them. If you are pained by external things, it is not they that disturb you, but your own judgment of them, and it is in your power to wipe out that judgment now. If we were to take a little stroll through history, if one could do that, of course, we would find a variety of different cultures that have basically taken it for granted that a person wasn't fully human unless they learned to master their thoughts and feelings. However, there are certain historical periods, I didn't want to do any finger pointing, but our own historical period, where this ability to control oneself is not held in high esteem. In fact, those who end up attempting it are pretty much thought to be ridiculous or uptight or completely out of it or a square or whatever little saying you want to give them. Thankfully, regardless of the dictates of fashion, those who end up taking the time to gain mastery over what happens in their own mind are going to live happier lives. Period. All right. It should be pretty clear at this point that although humanity has done quite a bit in terms of improving its material powers, it really hasn't advanced very far in terms of improving the quality of experience. I mean, yeah, there are some ancient traditions out there that have done that. I'm thinking about the Bhagavad Gita or the Upanishads or the Rig Vedas or the Brahman Sutras or Patanjali's yoga system, or if you start getting into the sutras of Buddhism, like there are some pretty decent attempts out there. And even within the Western tradition, we have modern psychology and existentialism and other different forms of philosophy and science that have attempted to improve the content of experience. But overall, we really haven't made much ground on that. This is where Mihai comes into play. He ended up saying that only when we understand the way subjective states are shaped can we master them. And if you sit down and think about it, everything we experience in life, our joys and pains and frustrations and interests and boredoms, all of these are going to be represented in the mind as information. Take a moment and think about all of the information that's entering into your mind at any given moment. I mean, my gosh, it's practically infinite. The amount of sights and sounds and smells and tastes and the things that you end up touching, I mean, even that within itself is absolutely vast, and we're not even talking about the types of social situations. I mean, there's a lot of people out there, there's a lot of different objects that you can focus your attention on. It is practically infinite. But the thing is that we seem to have a selective capacity within our mind. You get to choose what sort of things that you're going to emphasize. You know, this actually reminds me of an experiment that I heard about. And again, I don't remember the person that conducted it, so If you're interested, you'll have to go back and double check who that was. But anyways, there were two teams. I think there was a black team and a white team. I guess I don't recall the colors as well too, or how many people were involved in that. But anyways, each team would end up passing a basketball between each other. And a person was brought in and they were asked to count the amount of times one team would end up passing the ball between them. So they would do that, and the experimenter at the end would ask, all right, so how many times? And maybe it was 16 times that they ended up passing, and the person would give their answer. But then the experimenter ended up saying, did you see the gorilla? And the vast majority of these people were like, what gorilla? And they go back and they review the video, and midway through this experiment, a gorilla, or a person in a gorilla suit, I suppose, walks right into the middle of all of these people passing basketballs, bangs his chest, and walks off. And the vast majority of the participants couldn't see the gorilla. They were so focused on counting the amount of times that the ball was passed between these individuals that they didn't even end up noticing a gorilla right in their field of vision. And it wasn't like they were there for just a moment. They were there for like 3 to 5 seconds. It was a pretty long duration of time, and they completely missed it because they were focusing their attention on one particular aspect. I mean, how amazing is that? So again, there is a near infinite sea of information out there, and all of that's a potential candidate for entering into your mind. So the things that you actually point out and the things that you direct your attention towards is going to be so much smaller than the things that you end up leaving out. I mean, think about it. If you ended up having a situation where you couldn't even see a gorilla walking into your field of vision, you're leaving a lot of things out, that's for sure. We do not have an infinite capacity to catch everything in our environment. An individual can only experience so much. Therefore, the information that we do allow into our minds is incredibly important. In fact, that's what's going to determine the content and the quality of our lives. You might be asking yourself at this point, how do we end up selecting information to enter into our minds? Well, you can do that consciously, of course, by directing your own attention towards something, like the participants were directing their attention towards the balls being passed between a certain team, or you can end up following your old mental habits or biological programming or the social instructions that you were given. All of these are going to be ways that we can end up filtering our experience. The mark of a person who has gained a certain degree of control over their consciousness are those who have the ability to focus their attention at will. They're the ones that are oblivious to all the external distractions and can concentrate for lengthy periods of time to achieve something important, and they are able to rest after the fact. These are the people that are filtering their experience in a very positive way. The moment that you're capable of controlling the information entering your mind is the moment you end up directing the course of your own life. It seems like a good time to mention one of the coolest topics mentioned within the book. Well, at least according to my own personal tastes. Mihai ended up saying that because attention determines what will or will not appear in consciousness, and it's pretty much connected with all other forms of mental events, like remembering and thinking and feeling and making decisions, like all of these are going to be connected to how we use our attention. So, therefore, it's actually useful to think of attention as a form of psychic energy. Cool, right? So, if attention is like energy, and then you really can't perform any type of work without it, like you can't think or remember or do any of those things that I mentioned prior without utilizing your attention, you can think about any time that you do those things, you're actually using up that energy, and it's limited. Yep, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but we do not have an unlimited resource of attention. Yeah, it's going to be used up eventually. You can't focus your attention on something indefinitely. That just doesn't happen. So, you can either allocate this limited resource by focusing it intentionally, like a beam of laser, or by diffusing it in desultory random movements. The choice is entirely up to you. Although this analogy wasn't mentioned within the book, I do find it rather helpful in understanding how psychic energy can be focused. So if you're distracted and not really paying attention to what you're doing and your mind is constantly flipping between different thoughts rather randomly, you can think about your psychic energy as being the light produced by a light bulb. Now, the light produced by a light bulb is incredibly inefficient. The reason for that is that the photons it produces, which are elementary particles of light, are non-coherent, which is to say they work against each other, and they create destructive wave patterns, and they cancel each other out. So the intensity of light produced by one light bulb is going to be about 1 watt per square centimeter of light, which isn't very much. The light from the sun, on the other hand, is 6,000 times more powerful because the photons it emits are more coherent. These photons work with each other. They create constructive wave patterns and synchronize their efforts together. So instead of behaving like disorderly parts, these photons work together like a well-rehearsed marching band. And here's where things get interesting. If you were to get all the photons of that 1 watt light bulb to become coherent and resonate in harmony with each other, the energy density would be thousands to millions of times greater than the surface of the sun. I mean, that's crazy if you think about it. Most people's psychic energy resembles the light bulb, incredibly inefficient and incredibly unfocused. Whereas there are a few people out there, I'm thinking mostly of the yogis, or those guys that spend years meditating in caves that are more or less virtuosos at the control of their own consciousness. I mean, these are like laser beams that can cut through a planet. I mean, their psychic energy is incredibly focused by comparison. So the question is, how do we turn our psychic energy from a light bulb to a laser beam? One way to go about it is to figure out what sorts of things are going to cause psychic disorder. Mihai said that any information that conflicts with our existing intentions or distracts us from carrying them out is going to fall under that category. That being said, psychic disorder comes in a whole variety of forms. Pain, fear, rage, anxiety, jealousy, pretty much any afflictive emotion forces our attention away from what we want to accomplish. During these states, our psychic energy is incredibly ineffective and inefficient, just like that 1 watt light bulb. The exact opposite of psychic disorder is going to be optimal experience. And yes, it took me, oh, I don't know, a little over 20 minutes to finally get around to mentioning that. Yeah, I'm starting to notice a trend with these lectures. I'm sure you'll get used to it with time, right? But anyways, when information keeps entering into your awareness that's congruent with your goals and your intentions, your psychic energy is going to flow effortlessly, and it's going to resemble that laser beam far more than a light bulb. So how do we get into a state of optimal experience? Well, first of all, we have to be invested towards realistic goals. That's incredibly important. Not only that, you also have to have your skills match up with the opportunities for action. When you're pursuing a realistic goal, and this can come in a variety of different forms, it could be playing a musical instrument, or being involved in some sort of sporting event, or rock climbing, or painting a painting, like whatever. There are countless things that can be realistic goals that you can end up following. And during that time, your mind or consciousness or awareness is going to be in a state of order because you have to concentrate your attention on what you're doing. And during that time, you momentarily forget about everything else. All of those distractions that are causing that psychic disorder, those are all washed away in the midst of pursuing these types of goals. If you were to look back at your life and search out the best moments that you had, it's usually going to be during times that your mind and body were stretched to its limits. And these were typically in an effort to accomplish something difficult, or worthwhile, or meaningful. That being said, optimal experiences are something we can make happen. And, in the long run, if you continue to challenge yourself and stretch your skills and push yourself to higher and higher heights by following realistic goals and having your skills match up to the opportunities for your actions, you're going to become an increasingly extraordinary individual. And if you end up approaching these experiences voluntarily, you'll end up discovering that you are determining the content of your own life. And that is about as close as we can get to finding happiness. So, what word do we use for people involved in these optimal states? Mihai uses the word flow, And this is the way people typically describe their state of mind when their consciousness is harmoniously ordered, when they're involved in some meaningful pursuit or goal or doing something for its own sake. Just to use a few examples from my own personal experience, I find that playing music is one of my favorite ways of getting into a state of flow. When you end up acquiring a certain degree of proficiency on the instrument, shall we say a guitar in this particular case, you get to express yourself through your knowledge. Your thoughts and your intentions and your feelings and all of your senses are just focused on one goal, making the music. And your experience is in a state of harmony. And during that time, everything dissolves away. It's just you and your music. Time ends up losing all sense of objectivity. It just flies right by. You can spend hours goofing around on the instrument, and it just seems like minutes. And not only that, when you end up getting done with these types of experiences, you feel more together than you were before. I mean, not only internally, but with respect to other people in the world as well. It's like you become a more unique individual, less predictable. You're possessed with rarer and rarer skills. It's rather remarkable. In short, when you experience a state of flow, you become an increasingly more complex person. And, paradoxically, when you end up acting freely and doing an action for its own sake rather than some ulterior motive, you learn to become more and more than what you were before. That's a remarkable insight. Certainly one worthy of this series, that's for sure. At this point, I would like to point out a distinction made by Mihai within the book regarding pleasure and enjoyment. So pleasure is a feeling of contentment that you get when you end up meeting the expectations set by biological programs or by social conditioning. So you end up chilling out in the evening while passively absorbing information from TV and movies and playing video games and dulling your mind overexcited by the demands of work with alcohol or drugs, and all of this is rather relaxing. But it doesn't produce psychological growth. Nope, not in the slightest. Enjoyment, on the other hand, is characterized by this forward movement. It's gaining a sense of novelty, of accomplishment, of moving towards a particular goal that you've decided for yourself, that you've considered meaningful. So when you're playing a close game of chess, or playing music, or rock climbing, or painting, or doing anything that ends up stretching your abilities, it's going to be incredibly enjoyable. Not only that, reading works of literature that ends up revealing things in a new light, or having a conversation that really allows you to express ideas that you didn't know you had, all of these are producing psychological growth, and they're going to be categorized under the heading of enjoyment. The main difference between the two is we can experience pleasure without any investment of psychic energy whatsoever, whereas enjoyment only ends up happening as a result of unusual investments of attention. Yeah, it really doesn't take a considerable amount of effort to get into a state of pleasure. I mean, so long as the appropriate centers in your brain are electrically stimulated, or are there as a result of chemical stimulation of drugs, or getting a dopamine kick from watching shows that you enjoy, all of these don't require much effort whatsoever. On the contrary, it's impossible to enjoy activities like rock climbing, or playing music, or playing tennis, or any other sport, or reading a very invigorating work of literature, or having an in-depth conversation, unless your attention was fully involved on the activity at hand. That's the difference. Now, for a lot of people, that natural connection between growth and enjoyment seems to disappear with time. I don't know if that's an unfortunate consequence of the educational system that we live within. I mean, from my own personal experience, I remember K through 12 as being incredibly stifling. The whole learning process was completely ruined by my teacher's expectations or all of these extra educational agendas like follow orders and be there on time and strict discipline and all these things that had nothing to do with learning. And I think as a result of that, the excitement of mastering new skills gradually wears out. That's an incredibly sad prospect. Unfortunately, if you end up losing that enjoyment and you end up moving towards your state of pleasure, eventually you're going to atrophy and then life becomes merely adequate, and for a lot of people it's going to be rather dismal, so we need to be able to find enjoyment within our lives. Perhaps I'll use another example of an activity that I enjoy thoroughly that ends up bringing about a state of flow pretty much every time I end up playing it, and that's going to be chess. And during this time, I'm going to try to elucidate on the phenomenology of enjoyment, which Mihai ended up saying has 8 major components. And by the way, if that last statement was completely incomprehensible, it pretty much means what makes an activity enjoyable. First of all, whenever I sit down to a game of chess, I know this is a task that I can complete. It's not like I'm trying to swim the Mississippi River or run the Boston Marathon in record time or climb the highest mountain with an arm tied behind my back. Like, I know that I can complete this task, not so much for the other task, but this is something that I can complete, win or lose. Also, whenever I'm involved within this activity, I get to concentrate on what I'm doing. There might be a variety of different distractions all outside of me, but I don't really pay attention to them. I'm focused on the task at hand. I'm trying to figure out what my opponent is up to, and I start thinking about my candidate moves and which ones are going to be the best one for the position, and I start considering, well, is my king safe? Do I have any opportunities for tactics? I mean, do we have to start looking at it from a strategical interpretation? Do I start defending certain areas? Like, there's so many different variables that you have to start considering, and what's really fun is that I get to be completely involved within that situation. And there's nothing outside impinging upon my attention. It's just the game at hand. Chess, much to its advantage, also has clearly stated goals. The point? To get your opponent in the checkmate. I mean, when you're playing, you don't want to be so simplistic about it. I mean, yeah, that is the underlying objective, of course, but you have a variety of different goals leading up to that primary goal, and if you end up approaching it through that very vague interpretation, you're probably not going to do really well against a skilled opponent. But the name of the game is checkmate. That's it. You know exactly what you're up to, you know exactly what to defend against. This is the point of the game. In addition to that, chess has immediate feedback. If you end up making a poor move and end up pressing your attack before it was ready, your opponent can make an immediate rebuttal, and then you're right back to the drawing board. And if there's any, shall we say, gap between what you do and what you experience, it's really difficult to get into a state of flow. I mean, imagine yourself playing a video game that has load spikes happening all the time, where you're losing, you know, 3 to 5 seconds within the context of your game. You're not going to be able to enjoy yourself that much because there's too much of a gap between what you do and what you experience. And the larger the gap, the more difficult it is to be able to have a flow experience. And no, before you point out the obvious inconsistency between my comments there by saying that, well, wait a second now, chess is super slow, so you make a move right and all of a sudden your opponent takes 45 minutes calculating what they want to do and then they move, like, well, that's a very large delay. Like, all right, granted, but during the time that you're waiting for your opponent to move, you're constantly analyzing, you're constantly evaluating the circumstances and creating plans and thinking about the move orders to execute that plan, and then you have to have sub-plans within that plan, and not only that, you have to consider what your opponent is up to, so you are, in a sense, constantly being engaged within that. And although the moves seem to be happening relatively slow on the surface, if you end up, shall we say, comparing that to a video game action, like, it's still incredibly eventful within the context of a chess player, so don't cop out on that. It's still it's a total situation of immediate feedback, even though it might take some time before your opponent to actually move. So, just pointing that out. All right, what else makes chess enjoyable? Well, during that activity, all worries of everyday life are completely washed away. There's a sort of effortless involvement within that activity. All of the trivialities within life, like, what should I get for groceries tonight? Or, I think I had that meal yesterday. Should I do something different? Or, did I mail that letter? I should probably do that later this afternoon. Or, what does that person think of me? Like, all of these types of things don't end up occurring within your mind. It's just the activity at hand. So you're completely involved in what you're doing. The 6th component that makes an activity enjoyable, and chess has this as well, is that we have a sense of control over our actions. nobody's forcing you to do anything. That night move that you pressed up the board that got taken for free, like that was your choice. Nobody told you to do that. You alone are responsible for that decision. And yeah, it's true that you have to play within the rules of the game that you're in. You can't say push a pawn five squares forward or jump over pieces with your rook. I mean, there's still rules that restrict your movements, but you end up expressing yourself through those rules as creatively as you want. And this applies to pretty much any activity that you can gain enjoyment from. There's freedom within it. You can move how you see fit. Well, within that limited framework, that is. Similar to the few other ideas that I mentioned earlier, when you're immersed within this activity, you lose all sense of self. Like, you're not worried about things that are occurring within your daily life. Like, you're not worried about how other people are thinking about you. You're not thinking about yourself in relation to other people, whether they're higher on the social stratosphere or whatever the circumstances may end up being. Like, you don't care about that stuff. It's just you and the activity at hand. And it's you analyzing the position and prioritizing your moves and finding a particular weakness and figuring out ways how to exploit it, and you're thinking about move order and how to go about implementing tactics and forcing weaknesses, and there's so many different things that you're considering, and none of it has to do with who you are. It's nothing about that. It's the game that you're involved with. And what's really interesting is that as you dissolve your sense of self and get immersed within the game, when you're done with that activity, you end up having a stronger sense of self as a result of that. That's the psychological growth that I mentioned earlier. And lastly, whenever you're involved in enjoyable activities, your sense of time is drastically altered. It seems as though hours can pass like minutes. Like, it's very weird how it all ends up happening. Like, I've had situations where I was immersed within a game and then all of a sudden I stood up like, well, that was a fun 45 minutes, and and then 2.5 hours passed, and it was just shocking to see how quickly that time flew by. And if there's any activity that you can get involved within and all of a sudden you just glance up at the clock and you're absolutely shocked, there's a pretty good chance that this is a type of activity that brings enjoyment, that you're getting into a state of flow as a result of it. So again, these are the 8 different things that ends up leading towards an enjoyable experience. And I'll go ahead and go through that real quick here again. So 1, you can complete the task. 2, you get to concentrate on what you're doing. 3, you have clear goals. 4, you have immediate feedback. 5, all worries of everyday life are washed away. 6, your sense of control over your actions is very much a part of it. 7, your concern for yourself disappears. And 8, your sense of the duration of time is going to be drastically altered. These are the qualities or the components that make up enjoyable activities. Something important that I should mention at this point, and this is especially true within the context of this bizarre culture, is that when beating your opponent takes precedence over performing as best as you possibly can, enjoyment is going to disappear quickly. Competition is only enjoyable when it's a means to perfecting your skills, to getting to that next level, to refine your abilities, and when it becomes an end within itself, it ceases to be fun. Please take that under advisement. Alright, now I get to mention one of my favorite concepts mentioned within the book, and I'm even going to go so far as to plop this chart up there. And yes, that is the first time that I've ever done that. It was that cool that I felt inclined that I had to do that. Anyways, within this book, Mihai mentioned that enjoyment typically comes at a very specific point, and that is whenever the opportunities for action that are perceived by the individual are equal to his or her capabilities. So, let's go back to our chess example, and let's just say that you're figuring out the moves, like, alright, pawns move like that, and they attack like this, and here's a knight, and moves in these L-shaped configurations, and bishops go diagonal, and so on and so forth, so you're just figuring out the basic moves. And now you're confronted by your first opponent, who happens to be a grandmaster, and he decided to take off the kid gloves and absolutely smash you. So the thing is that during that particular situation, the challenges are way higher than your skills, and you're probably just going to be frustrated as a result of that. You're not going to get a lot of enjoyment from that activity, and that's unfortunate. So let's just say that your skills are improving. you're learning about tactics, and you're learning about king safety, and you're learning about all of the different principles of good play. And as your skills end up increasing, you have to have challenges that are meeting up with that. So let's just say that you're actually getting pretty good now. You can weave through positions rather easily, but now let's just say that you come across a bunch of, shall we say, beginners that were at the same level that you were at when you first began. And now let's just say that you can absolutely crush them as this grandmaster crushed you. And the thing is that during that situation, the challenges are not up to the degree of your skills, and therefore it's going to be boring. So if the challenges are too much, you're going to be frustrated, and if they're not challenging enough, you're going to be bored. So there's this flow channel that exists between those two variables. Like, what a really neat concept that is. Enjoyment exists at the boundary between boredom and anxiety. And if you can end up balancing your challenges with your capacity to act, you're going to be able to find a state of flow rather readily. What a brilliant idea. Just to reiterate, if you end up overly indulging in your pleasures and do nothing but passively absorb information and not really end up utilizing any skills or exploring new opportunities for growth or for action, you're going to live a pretty, how do I put this? Insignificant life. You are not going to have a lot of control over what happens within your own mind, and disorder is eventually going to take over. Instead, you should learn to focus your psychic energy, to be able to hold your attention on things for as long as you see fit, and to be able to fall into a state of flow as easily as it is to breathe or beat your heart or anything like that. And if you're able to do that, the course of your life is going to reach an entirely different level. Alienation is going to give way to involvement. Enjoyment will replace your boredom. That feeling of helplessness that seems to be at the core of your being, that's going to give way to a feeling of control. And everything is going to be there to reinforce a sense of self instead of being lost in the service of other people's agendas and motivations. So the thing is that when you end up experiencing flow on a regular basis, life is intrinsically rewarding. It justifies the present moment. And instead of being held hostage for some, you know, hypothetical goal that people are putting in front of your nose like a carrot on a stick, you get to determine the course of your own life. You get to basically have life being an end within itself, and that is a state of flow. You enjoy it for its own sake.